Chapter 1 of Dot and the Kangaroo. Lost her way in the bush. She knew it, and was very frightened. She was too frightened, in fact, to cry, but stood in the middle of a little dry, bare space, looking around her at the scraggy growths of prickly shrubs that had torn her little dress to rags, scratched her bare legs and feet till they bled, and pricked her hands and arms as she had pushed madly through the bushes for hours, seeking her home. Sometimes she looked up to the sky, but little of it could be seen because of the great tall trees that seemed to her to be trying to reach heaven with their far-off crooked branches. She could see little patches of blue sky between the tangled tufts of drooping leaves, and, as the dazzling sunlight had faded, she began to think it was getting late, and that very soon it would be night. The thought of being lost and alone in the wild bush at night took her breath away with fear, and made her tired little legs tremble under her. She gave up all hope of finding her home, and sat down at the foot of the biggest blackbutt tree, with her face buried in her hands and knees, and thought of all that had happened, and what might happen yet. It seemed such a long, long time since her mother had told her that she might gather some bush flowers while she cooked the dinner, and Dot recollected how she was bid not to go out of sight of the cottage. How she wished now that she had remembered this sooner. But while she was picking the pretty flowers, a hare suddenly started at her feet and sprang away into the bush, and she had run after it. When she found that she could not catch the hare, she discovered that she could no longer see the cottage. After wandering for a while, she got frightened and ran, little knowing that she was going further away from her home at every step. Where she was sitting under the blackbutt tree, she was miles away from her father's selection, and it would be very difficult for anyone to find her. She felt that she was a long way off, and she began to think of what was happening at home. She remembered how, not very long ago, a neighbour's little boy had been lost, and how his mother had come to their cottage for help to find him, and that the father had ridden off on the big bay horse to bring men from all the selections around to help him in the search. She remembered their coming back in the darkness, numbers of strange men she had never seen before. Old men, young men, and boys, all on their rough-coated horses, and how they came indoors, and what a noise they made, all talking together in the big, deep voices. They looked terrible men, so tall and brown and fierce, with their rough, bristly beards, and they all spoke in such funny tones to her, as if they were trying to make their voices small. During many days these men came and went, and every time they were more sad and less noisy. The little boy's mother used to come and stay, crying whilst the men were searching the bush for her little son. Then, one evening, Dot's father came home alone, and both her mother and the little boy's mother went away in a great hurry. Then, very late, her mother came back crying, and her father sat smoking by the fire, looking very sad, and she never saw that little boy again, although he had been found. She wondered now if all these rough big men were riding into the bush to find her, and if, after many days, they would find her, and no one would ever see her again. She seemed to see her mother crying, and her father very sad, and all the men very solemn. These thoughts made her so miserable that she began to cry herself. Dot does not know how long she was sobbing in loneliness and fear, with her head on her knees, and with her little hands covering her eyes so as not to see the cruel wild bush in which she was lost. It seemed a long time before she summoned up the courage to uncover her weeping eyes and look once more at the bare, dry earth, and the wilderness of scrub and trees that seemed to close her in as if she were in a prison. When she did look up, she was surprised to see that she was no longer alone. She forgot all her troubles and fear in her astonishment at seeing a big, grey kangaroo squatting quite close to her, in front of her. What was most surprising was that the kangaroo evidently understood that Dot was in trouble, and was sorry for her, for down the animal's nice, soft, grey muzzle, two tiny little tears were slowly trickling. When Dot looked up at it with wonder in her round blue eyes, the kangaroo did not jump away, but remained gazing sympathetically at Dot with a slightly puzzled air. Suddenly the big animal seemed to have an idea, and it lightly hopped into the scrub, where Dot could just see it bobbing up and down, as if it were hunting for something. Presently back came the strange kangaroo with a spray of berries in her funny black hands. They were pretty berries. Some were green, some were red, some blue, and others white. Dot was quite glad to take them when the kangaroo offered them to her, and as this friendly animal seemed to wish her to eat them, she did so gladly, because she was beginning to feel hungry. After she had eaten a few berries, a very strange thing happened. While Dot had been alone in the bush, it had all seemed so dreadfully still. There had been no sound but the gentle stir of a light, fitful breeze in the faraway treetops. All around had been so quiet that her loneliness had seemed 20 times more lonely. Now, however, under the influence of these small sweet berries, Dot was surprised to hear voices everywhere. At first, it seemed like hearing sounds in a dream. They were so faint and distant. But soon the talking grew nearer and nearer, louder and clearer, until the whole bush seemed filled with talking. They were all little voices, some indeed quite tiny whispers and squeaks, but they were very numerous, and seemed to be everywhere. They came from the earth, from the bushes, from the trees, and from the very air. The little girl looked round to see where they came from, but everything just looked the same. Hundreds of ants, of all kinds and sizes, were hurrying to their nests. A few lizards were scuttling about amongst the dry twigs and sparse grasses. There were some grasshoppers, and in the trees birds fluttered to and fro. Then Dot knew that she was hearing and understanding everything that was being said by all the insects and creatures in the bush. All this time the kangaroo had been speaking, only Dot had been too surprised to listen. But now the gentle, soft voice of the kind animal caught her attention, and she found that the kangaroo was in the middle of a speech. "I understand what was the matter with you at once," she was saying, "for I feel just the same myself. I have been miserable, like you, ever since I lost my baby kangaroo. You must also have lost something. Tell me what it is." "I've lost my way," said Dot, rather wondering if the kangaroo would understand her. "Ah," said the kangaroo, quite delighted at her own cleverness. "I knew you had lost something. Isn't it a dreadful feeling? You feel as if you have no inside, don't you? And you're not inclined to eat anything, not even the youngest grass. I have been like that ever since I lost my baby kangaroo. Now tell me," said the creature confidently, "what your way is like. I may be able to find it for you." Dot found that she must explain what she meant by saying she had lost her way, and the kangaroo was much interested. "Well," she said, after listening to the little girl, "that is just like you humans. You are not fit for this country at all. Of course, if you only have one home in one place, you must lose it. If you made your home everywhere and anywhere, it would never be lost. Humans are no good in our bush," she continued. "Just look at yourself now. How do you compare with a kangaroo? There is your ridiculous sham coat. Well, you have lost bits of it all the way you have come today, and you're nearly left in your bare skin. Now look at my coat. I've done ever so much more hopping than you today, and you see I'm none the worse. I wonder why all your fur grows upon the top of your head," she said reflectively, as she looked curiously at Dot's long flaxen curls. "It's such a silly place to have one's fur the thickest. You see, we have very little there, for we don't want our heads made any hotter under the Australian sun. See how much better off you would be, now that nearly all your sham coat is gone, if that useless fur had been chopped into little short lengths and spread all over your poor bare body. I wonder why you humans are made so badly," she ended with a puzzled air. Dot felt for a moment as if she ought to apologise for being so unfit for the bush, and having all the fur coat on top of her head, but somehow she had an idea that a little girl must be something better than a kangaroo, although the kangaroo certainly seemed a very superior person, so she said nothing, but again began to eat the berries. "You must not eat any more of these berries," said the kangaroo anxiously. "Why?" asked Dot. "They are very nice, and I am very hungry." The kangaroo gently took the spray out of Dot's hand and threw it away. "You see," she said, "if you eat too many of them, you'll know too much." "I can't know too much," argued the little girl. "Yes, you can, though," said the kangaroo quickly. "If you eat too many of those berries, you'll learn too much, and that gives you indigestion. Then you become very miserable. I don't want you to be miserable any more, for I'm going to find your lost way." The mention of finding her way reminded the little girl of her sad position, which, in her wonder at talking with the kangaroo, had been quite forgotten for a little while. She became sad again, and seeing how dim the light was getting, her thoughts went back to her parents. She longed to be with them, to be kissed and cuddled, and her blue eyes filled with tears. "Your eyes just now remind me of two fringed violets with the morning dew on them, or after a shower," said the kangaroo. "Why are you crying?"
"I was thinking," said Dot.
"Oh, don't think," pleaded the kangaroo. "I never do myself."
"I can't help it," explained the little girl. "What do you do instead?" she asked.
"I always jump to conclusions," said the kangaroo, and she promptly bounded 10 feet at one hop. Lightly springing back again to her position in front of the child, she added, "And that's why I've never had a headache."
"Dear kangaroo," said Dot, "do you know where I can get some water? I'm very thirsty."
"Of course you are," said her friend. "Everyone is at sundown. I'm thirsty myself, but the nearest waterhole is a longish way off, so we had better start at once." Little Dot got up with an effort. After her long run and fatigue, she was very stiff, and her little legs were so tired and weak that after a few steps she staggered and fell. The kangaroo looked at the child compassionately. "Poor little human," she said. "Your legs aren't much good, and, for the life of me, I don't understand how you can expect to get along without a tail."
"The waterhole is a good way off," she added, with a sigh, as she looked down at Dot, lying on the ground, and she was very puzzled what to do.
But suddenly she brightened up. "I have an idea," she said joyfully. "Just step into my pouch, and I'll hop you down to the waterhole in less time than it takes a locust to shrill." Timidly and carefully, Dot did the kangaroo's bidding, and found herself in the cosiest, softest little bag imaginable. The kangaroo seemed overjoyed when Dot was comfortably settled in her pouch. "I feel as if I had had my baby kangaroo again," she exclaimed, and immediately she bounded away through the tangled scrub, over the stones and bushes, over dry watercourses and great fallen trees, and all Dot felt was a gentle rocking motion and a fresh breeze in her face, which made her so cheerful that she sang this song. "If you want to go quick, I will tell you a trick. For the bush there isn't a train. With a hullabaloo, hail a big kangaroo, but be sure that your weight she'll sustain. Then with hop and with skip, she'll take you a trip with the speed of the very best steed. And this is a truth for which I can vouch. There's no carriage can equal a kangaroo's pouch. Oh, where is a friend so strong and true as a dear big bounding kangaroo? Goodbye, goodbye," the lizards all cry, each drying its eyes with its tail. "Adieu, adieu, dear kangaroo," the scared little grasshoppers wail. "They're going express to a distant address," says the bandicoot, ready to scoot. "And your path is well cleared for your progress, I vouch, when you ride through the bush in a kangaroo's pouch. Oh, where is a friend so strong and true as a dear big bounding kangaroo? Away, away, you will certainly say, to the end of the farthest blue, to the verge of the sky and the far hills high, oh, take me with thee, kangaroo. We will see for the end where the broad plains tend, even as far as the evening star. Why, the end of the world we can reach, I vouch, dear kangaroo with me in your pouch. Oh, where is a friend so strong and true as a dear big bounding kangaroo?" End of chapter 1 of Dot and the Kangaroo, recording by Tess. Chapter 2 of Dot and the Kangaroo by Ethel C. Pedley. She asked why everything must be so quiet, but as she peeped out, she saw that the kangaroo was making a very dangerous descent, and she did not like to trouble her friend with questions just then. They seemed to be going down to a great deep gully that looked almost like a hole in the earth, the depth was so great, and the hills around came so closely together. The way the kangaroo was hopping was like she was going down the side of a wall. Huge rocks were tumbled around here and there. Some looked as if they would come rolling down upon them, and others appeared as if a little jolt would send them crashing and tumbling into the darkness below. Where the kangaroo found room to land on its feet, after each bound, puzzled Dot, for there seemed no foothold anywhere. It all looked so dangerous to the little girl that she shut her eyes so as not to see the terrible places they bounded over or rested on. She felt sure the kangaroo must lose her balance, or hop just a little too far or a little too near, and that they would fall together over the side of that terrible wild cliff. At last she said, "Oh, Kangaroo, shall we get safely to the bottom, do you think?" "I never think," said the Kangaroo, "but I know we shall. This is the easiest way. If I went through the thick bush on the other side, I should stand a chance of running my head against a tree at every leap. Unless I got a stiff neck with holding my head on one side, looking out of one eye all the time. My nose gets in the way when I look straight in front," she explained. "Don't be afraid," she continued. "I know every jump of the way. We kangaroos have gone this way ever since Australia began to have kangaroos. Look here," she said, pausing on a big boulder that hung right over the gully. "We have made a history book for ourselves out of these rocks. And so long as these rocks last, long, long after the time when there will be no more kangaroos and no more humans, the sun and the moon and the stars will look down upon what we have traced on these stones." Dot peered out from her little refuge in the kangaroo's pouch and saw the glow of a twilight sky reflected on the top of a boulder. The rough surface of the stone shone with a beautiful polish like a looking-glass, for the rock had been rubbed for thousands of years by the soft feet and tails of millions of kangaroos, kangaroos that had hopped down that way to get water. When Dot saw that, she didn't know why it all seemed so solemn, or why she felt like such a very little girl. She was a little sad, and the kangaroo, after a short sigh, continued her way. As they neared the bottom of the gully, the kangaroo became extremely cautious. She no longer hopped in the open, but made her way with little leaps through the thick scrub. She peeped carefully out before each movement. Her long, soft ears kept moving to catch every sound, and her black, sensitive little nose was constantly lifted, sniffing the air. Every now and then, she gave little backward starts, as if she were going to retreat by the way she had come, and Dot, with her face pressed against the kangaroo's soft furry coat, could hear her heart beating so fast that she knew she was very frightened. They were not alone. Dot could hear whispers from unseen little creatures everywhere in the scrub, and from the birds in the trees. High up in the branches were numbers of pigeons, sweet little bronze wings, and above all the other sounds, she could hear their plaintive voices crying, "We're so frightened, we're so frightened, so thirsty and so frightened, so thirsty and so frightened." "Why don't they drink at the waterhole?" whispered Dot. "Because they're frightened," was the answer. "Frightened of what?" asked Dot. "Humans," said the kangaroo in frightened tones. And as she spoke, she reared up upon her long legs and tail, so that she stood at least 6 feet high and peeped over the bushes, her nose working all round and her ears wagging. "I think it's safe," she said as she squatted down again. "Friend Kangaroo," said a bronze wing that had sidled out to the end of a neighbouring branch, "you are so courageous. Will you go first to the water and let us know if it is all safe? We haven't tasted a drop of water for 2 days," she said sadly, "and we're dying of thirst. Last night, when we had waited for hours to make certain there were no cruel humans about, we flew down for a drink, and we wanted, oh, so little, just 3 little sips. But the terrible humans with their bang-bangs murdered numbers of us. Then we flew back, and some were hurt and bleeding, and died of their wounds, and none of us have dared to get a drink since." Dot could see that the poor pigeon was suffering great thirst, for its wings were drooping, and its poor beak was open. The kangaroo was very distressed at hearing the pigeon's story. "It's dreadful."
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.